world famous behemoth, it's Mr. Friday Night Jack D.
Thank you for that thunderous round of applause there. Of course, you want to know I have a headache, but... I don't suppose you really thought about it that much, did you? It's just us. The whole time. Anyway, welcome down the club. I think you'll know what I mean when I say the weekend starts here. Yeah, I've got a bit of a headache. I don't mind admitting. I was out last night, Thursday. I was out celebrating my wife's birthday, and I didn't get in till like 4 o'clock in the morning, and gosh, she was livid. Oh. We've got Cindi Lauper on the show tonight. It's going to be fantastic. Yeah, it is. Yeah. A reason I have a music intro when I come on stage is so I don't have to listen to all the whispering and muttering that goes on when I actually arrive on stage. I guess I get kind of fed up with that, you know.
He's quite small, isn't he?
Oh, yeah, have your laugh, please. I get this all the time now. People say to me, they come up to me in the street and say, you're not as big as you are on telly, are you? I said, well, I don't know. How big's your bloody television? I've had it all my life. I've had it since I was at school. I've had it since I was a kid. I went to one of these schools where the whole motto, the whole premise of the school was like, prepare the student for life, right? In the real sense of the word. So, like, for sport, we had to come in with a six-pack and 20 silk cut. Just sit around in little armchairs watching Grandstand. We used to go, good girl. Dinner time, we just go, put a Flinders pancake on for us, will ya? Yeah. Prepare the student for life in the real sense of the word. So like when I was 16, instead of leaving, I got called up to the headmaster's office. He made me redundant. That to me was like the worst night of my school career. It was like parent-teacher night. This is an idea baked up in the bowels of hell. You have to bring your parents in to meet your teachers and discuss, because inevitably, You've got a teacher who's like Adolf Eichmann all year. All of a sudden turns into Ronald McDonald for the evening, you know? You have to convince your parents on the way home. It seems like a very nice bloke to me. Not usually, he's bloody horrible usually. I don't know what all that was about. I've never seen that before. They say some weird, oh, you do that at home, do you? Huh? You do that at home, No, why do you throw board rubbers at home? I never understood that, the way... I mean, teachers write on the board in such a weird way, don't they? Because they'll do this. We say, sir, move over. Oh, thank you. I don't know where they teach it. Do they learn this some teacher's training college? Do they have, right, stupid ways to write on the blackboard? Here's one you might like to try. Imagine you're fencing. You see teachers on holiday, they're writing postcards like that. They go, all that anger coming out on the full stop, doesn't it? They go, oh, shit. I can't get an erection. Shit. You get the nice teacher You got the nice teacher who sets you home. And that's a different thing. You know, the teacher who actually does wish to inspire their pupils. The teacher who blesses you with that gift of wanting to learn. And when they come to set homework, it's a whole different story, isn't it? Right, for your homework, I want you to read pages 2 and 3. Oh, I see. Well, consider it done, sir. There were the nice teachers. We had a teacher, the trendy teacher. I don't know if you had one of these. He said, at the beginning of term, it was his first day there. Right, I want you to call me Dan. Okay. We will. Okay, but by the end of term, he was calling me Mr. D. We'll be going, what do you want, Dan? I'm talking with my friend, Mr. Thomas. The thing with teachers, right, and I'm not going to go on and on about this. I'm not bitter. I've got over it. The thing with teachers, I know, they're never off duty. Once a teacher, a whole bunch of you in a restaurant, and it'll be the one who's a teacher who will suddenly go, right, now shush everyone, listen. Right, have we all got a menu? Good, right. Well, if you haven't both got one, then I suggest you share. I'm surprised you don't know that by now. That was another weird gesture that was frightening me, that was, in class. Yeah, you can see through his fingers. Good, right. Who would like deep fried mushroom? You would, good. Anybody else? Right. No, I'm not asking Johnny, because Johnny's always got his hand up. Some poor bastard spills his drink. Now, that was a silly thing to do, wasn't it? Can't have a... You can laugh. I was late. I had to stand up for the whole bloody meal. Okay, now I want you to welcome my very special guest. She's all the way from New York. She is New York's finest. This is a song called Product of Misery. And this, ladies and gentlemen, is Cindi Lauper.
She left her heart out by the door. Everybody passed it by. They never bothered asking why. She's still locked up inside, watching as the world turns by. Now she's just a product of misery. I don't wanna live a life. She's just a product. I don't wanna live a life that. Don't wanna live a life that. Life that. I don't wanna live a life that. Just a product of misery. And it's said she must confess. Never came and never left. never could communicate. And now the time is much too late. Our passions lay to rest, buried with the wedding dress. Now she's just a product of misery. I don't want to live a life.
We'll have more from Cindi Lauper later. Fantastic stuff, though. Oh,
yeah. Oh. Well, something for everyone in this show, isn't there? It's nice to have you here. Thank you for laughing at that first word there. Oh, you're very welcome. It's a family show. It's nice to have you here. We weren't actually expecting the Adams, but that's nice anyway.
There will always be one teacher who you remember for the rest of your life. Even as I'm saying this, as I'm speaking, I'm sure you've got a name and a face in your minds. Yeah, right. And I had this teacher, right? And his name was Mr. Lund. And we had a nickname for him. Isn't that a great name to go into teaching with? You know, you'd have thought someone would have tipped him off at some point. Teachers training college, enrollment day. Your name, Lunt. I wouldn't really, I wouldn't know that. We did. Do you know what we called him? Do you know what our nickname for him was? We called him Mojo. And, you know, looking back, I can see what a tragic, wasted opportunity that was. I think... Just too young to know any better, really. We called him Mojo for reasons which I'll come to. There's a story behind this. Mr. Lunt had this way of going around the school making himself look more important than any other member of staff. He just had that look about him. You see, I'm not merely a teacher, I'm a head of department, I'm a member of the governing board, I'm an important man. Wherever I go, I'm in a hurry, I should not be bothered with the trivia of the school. You know how he gave this impression? Everywhere he went like this. see that? I don't even know it's there. No, the wind did that. I have my mind on higher things. And the reason we called him Mojo was we had a tuck shop. Remember tuck shop? You had a tuck shop, obviously. And they had sweets called Mojos. Did you have Mojos? Anyone remember Mojos? People might not remember Mojos. Basically, to recap very briefly, a Mojo was like an opal fruit, right? And what you would do, you'd get a whole bag of these things, you'd unwrap the sweet, put the sweet in your mouth, throw the wrapper on the ground. Like you should. Well, Mr. Lunt had an obsession with Mojo wrappers. Indeed, he could spot a Mojo wrapper from several hundred yards. It was awesome. He'd be coming across the yard with his little hurried look on, and he'd be coming across the yard and he'd suddenly freeze. And he'd go. It was like Steve McGarrett at the beginning of Hawaii 5-0. See that one? He'd be on, yeah, he would. I've just remembered that's what it was like. He'd be on the top of the building, he'd go. We had a deputy who'd appear looking through a broken window. Yeah. He'd come across, he'd freeze, and he'd go, Mojo! Please, it wasn't a funny thing. It was more of a sad sound, do you know what I mean? No, it was a sad thing. You couldn't laugh at a thing like this. It was a sad sound. It was, you'd hear this awful sound echoing around the corridors of the school, like a haunted Maya! We'd all be in class going, oh, that poor man. It was a sad sound, do you know what I mean? It was like, I don't know how, it was like the song of a whale or something. You know what I mean? A sad sound.
Maya!
There'd be teachers in other schools miles away. Communicating with him.
Oh, yeah?
One year we had a bunch of Japanese students in, they harpooned the bastard. Oh, he was obsessed. He was obsessed with Mojo rappers. He gave speeches about Mojo rappers. We'd be in assembly, and the headmaster would say, "Mr. Lump wants a few words. I want you to talk about Mojo rappers. I want you to talk about me and you." By now, incredibly difficult to understand. Half man, half fish. It was terrible to watch, you know. He went, "I want to jog, I'm just gonna be English. I'm seeing him on board your rubber. I'm just gonna show the dog shop." If you'd be in the front row and you start laughing at this, he'd come over, he'd hit you with his fin. But I mean, great. I mean, he was. One thing though, if you were in the vicinity and you heard this terrible sound, the call of the Mojo.
Mojo!
Oh, bollocks, I won't do it again. If you heard that sound, then you had to look around, and if it was you nearest that Mojo rapper, you had to go, okay, I got it, there you are. Oh, Christ. It was such a good distraction. This was the whole thing. In class, you could always get him off at a different subject. This was the glory of it. Because to me, the whole point of being a pupil, I thought, was to get the teacher onto a different subject. The whole point of being on the planet was to get them off at a tangent. You know, the teacher's idea was to get from A to B in the class. Your idea was to go... Right. And with each teacher, you got to know him well enough, you knew exactly how to get him off on a different subject. It'd be a different thing with each teacher, different kind of question, different time to pitch it. It'd be so, you'd say, sir, what were trains like when you were younger, please?
Trains? What? Trains? Well, of course, in those days, there was steam, you see. It was my briefcase. Have I shown you the photographs of my steam engines?
No, sir, I don't think you ever have. Gosh, you fascinating man. Just to think, a teacher and a life as well. But with Mr. Lunt, it was a gift. It was a gift. You'd be in the middle of a really boring geography lesson. All you had to do was just be looking out the window and you go, sir, I'm not sure, but I think it's a Mojo. Mojo? It's a Mojo. I'll be here for the afternoon. Okay. Well, now you're in a good mood. It's time to welcome back my special guest. Here, she's chosen her own song. This is an Ann Peebles number. It's called I Pity the Fool. Please welcome Cindi Lauper!
Oh, I pity the fool. them what they're doing. They're just standing there watching you make a fool of me. Well, look at the people. I know you wonder what they're doing. They're just standing there watching you make a fool of me. Ooh, I feel the fool.
Thanks to Cindi Lauper. Thanks to all of you for being a great audience. Yeah. Yeah. One thing I like to say about working down here that I've noticed is that there's never any sign of trouble. You know? It just kind of flares up without warning, doesn't it? Thank you very much for coming down. See you again, I hope. Good night. Thank you.
From the world famous Bohemia, it's Mr. Friday Night's Jack D.
Oh, thank you very much. Oh, thank you very much. Yeah. That makes me feel good. Thank you very much. You know, they say God made the world in 6 days. So what a cowboy. What do you think he did on the seventh day? I don't think he rested. I think he signed on. Listen, we have got a very good show ahead for you. I think you're going to look for it. You're going to enjoy it very much. We've got from Shakespeare's sister, we've got Marcella Detroit, so it's going to be a good show, yeah. Yeah, it is. I've actually been doing some stuff around the house, you know, trying to do a bit of DIY. And that is very, very frightening. Because you know what it's like? You'd be watching someone at their house with a drill, and they're doing DIY. And they're making it look so easy. They're going, "Wild! Wild!" Just while you're watching, they put a shelf up. So you think, I can do that. I'll have a go at that. So I went to the shop and I got myself this drill, right? This is something that only men know, right? Yeah. It is, I'm sorry, no, women, you don't know what I'm talking about here. What? Oh, come on. You don't know what I'm gonna say yet. This is something only men, what it is that men actually like drills rather a lot because, secretly, they think they're like guns. See, you never watched a man on his own. When he knows he's being watched, he'll be working away with his drill. He'll be going, oh, it's tiring. On his own, if he thinks he's not being watched, a different story. Yeah. Oh, shit. I actually got myself a drill that's got two handles, so it's like a machine gun. You know, I'm going around the house and I'm standing back, DIY squad. I love all that stuff. Though. I went in the shop to get this drill, and I'm a sucker for all that equipment. I bought the drill, and then I saw this belt. You see the utility belt? I said, "Oh, give us that. I've got to have that. I want the utility." Oh, it's got pockets. It's got everything, isn't it? I said, I'll have the utility belt, yeah. I said, knee pads, I must have knee pads. Yeah, please, knee pads. Goggles, I want goggles, please. I want a helmet, give me a hard hat. I need a hat. I come out of the shop looking like the bloody village people, you know. And no one told me that when you're drilling, you shouldn't actually press too hard on a plasterboard partition. I didn't know that. I mean, I found out. I was upstairs going. I'm up to my shoulder in wall. Are those shells ready yet? No, don't come up yet. It's not ready. Our nice new neighbour has stolen the drill. He's doing his DIY with my electricity. I was looking through this magazine, sort of interior decoration kind of thing, and there was a picture of stripped floorboards, right? And I'm a bit of a trendy wanker, so I thought, well, yeah, that's what I want, right? So I found out how to do it. I found out how to do your own stripped floorboards. What you need, I went to this shop, hire shop. And I said, "Can I have an industrial sander, please?" And the bloke stopped laughing and got up off the floor, and I filled in the appropriate paperwork and got it home. It's like having a lawnmower in your front room. I don't know, because I'd borrowed this DIY manual from my dad, which is ancient. I don't know how old it is. It's got pictures on it. You're not actually sure if they're drawings or photographs. Do you know what I mean? And there was a picture of a man sanding his floor. And he was dressed immaculately, had nicely pressed trousers, and a tie, and he was, you know, he had a bowler hat. I thought, I can do it. So I get this thing home, and I was just looking through the manual, so you see how I can do it. Right, okay, what happens? You just plug it in, and press the button. You work diagonally across your floorboards at all times, always diagonally across. I don't know if you actually used one of these things. What actually happens is you plug it in, you press the button, and it sort of goes, "Ah!" My carpet. I was going, "Oh, please, God, mate, that didn't happen." thought I got a trap door I didn't want, you know. And then, of course, the humiliation of having to get a build around to sort out the mess that I had made. The actual degradation of having to explain to him what I had done. Oh dear, oh dear, oh dear. What has happened here? Yeah, like you don't already bloody know, eh? No, make me explain it, why don't you? Just for your own fun. You know, one job I can actually do around the house that I'm actually very pleased about, I can actually bang a nail and bend it double in one blow. Oh, yeah, that's quite a skill, that is, yeah? I'm just looking for a job around the house where that's actually necessary. Because then I'll be in big demand. People will be ringing me up. I say, Jack, could you come round? I've got this nail needs bludging. Can you do that for me? We need a botch job done here. Could you? Yeah, no problem. I'll be round with my lump. I'm a... God, so clever how you do that. Thank you very much. It's a muck, you know. Say the only kind of nail I really have a problem with, those crinkle cut ones, you know? Well, you know, screws. Screws. Okay, well, music now. Here is someone I've been looking forward to introducing down at the Bohemia for a very, very long time. Here is someone who's written songs for Eric Clapton, Belinda Carlisle. This is a Motown classic. It's called You're All I Need to Get By. Please welcome Marcella Detroit. Let's hear it for her, please.
I took one look at you, and it was plain to see you were my destiny. My eyes flew open wide, I threw away my pride. I'd sacrifice for you, do anything you want me to. I will go where you lead, I'll be right there any time of need. And when I lose my will, you'll be right there to put me up. You to go a little bit higher.
Marcella Detroit, eh?
most aerodynamic production coupe on Earth, now has our smoothest V6 engine.
It was a real challenge. Develop a new tile for Kotex that fits better to protect better. But how? Make it curved. Women are. The first tile to be soft and gently gathered, designed to fit the body for real protection. The new Simplicity Curve Towel, confidently Kotex.
Did you hear about the trouble on the first floor?
Why, have you heard something?
Morrison's out.
You sure? I thought he was here for life.
He's, retiring.
I never thought he'd retire.
Neither did he.
There may be trouble ahead, but while there's moonlight and music and love and romance, let's face the music and dance. Let's face the music and dance.
Does he know something we don't?
I don't know.
You needn't worry if your life changes. Allied Dunbar Financial Plans adapt to help you cope with the unexpected. Allied Dunbar, for the life you don't yet know.
She hears something about drugs and goes berserk. She doesn't even listen, just works herself up.
What about that?
Treats me like a kid.
I mean,
screaming and shouting.
Tell
me what to do.
Don't answer me back.
I can make up my own mind. Anyway, my mates know more about it than she does.
If you don't talk to your child about drugs, someone else will. Phone 0800 555 777 for a parent's guide.
Oh, thank you very much. There you go. Wow. Oh, thank you very much. I was talking about DIY. You know, for me it is a nightmare, I have to admit. The whole DIY scene is a nightmare. And the nightmare begins in the DIY store. I think it's the music. I think it's the girl from Eponina does it for me every time. I'm just wandering around. Boo. Oh, this is nice music, isn't it? Oh. Plus, someone somewhere obviously had the idea, if I put all my staff into baseball caps and boiler suits, then they'll be really efficient. No. Now, frankly, you might as well have bought them all little badges saying, "Hi, my name's Tom, I haven't got a clue." Yeah. Now, frankly, it is a miracle if you can get these people to stop playing with their assholes when they're talking to you. Why do they do that? Why? Excuse me, can you tell me where the chisels are? I can admit now that I'm no good at the stuff. I'm no good at doing this DIY thing. And I actually know why as well. I know why I'm no good at it. And this is because my dad would never let me watch him when he was doing stuff around the house. He wouldn't have that. He just couldn't have it. And when it came to this, my mum would get us together, all the children together, and she'd say, "Right, now your dad's going to do some decorating, okay? And we're all going to stay out of his way, all right?" No. I'd like to watch. No, you can't. We wanted to go out in the garden. My dad would go into the room that has been singled out for his treatment. They put big blankets in the windows. We're not going to watch what was going on. It'd be cotton wool in the locks, the whole lot, you know? We didn't know what was going on. All we could hear was a whistle to begin with, you know? A confident whistle, you know? I could have done this for a living, kind of a whistle, yeah? About half an hour later, this has gone down to a frustrated hum. You know, sort of... I won't clean the brushes, I'll throw them away. I won't do two coats, I'll just put posters everywhere. About 3 hours later, we're all out in the garden, we're just kicking a ball around. And suddenly beneath the ground would start to rumble beneath our feet. And we'd hear this... We'll be looking over to the house. Little animals in the hedgerow go. The dog decides to take a walk. I know he's going to get a bloody kick now. And we'll hear this unbelievable... Oh, shit! We'd all be going, what's going on? I'm frightened.
Shitty glow. Oh, wanking bloody arseholes. Stink the wallpaper.
On and on. Into the night. Screaming. Sounds like my dad was a decorating werewolf. The priests were coming to the door. For many days and many nights, no food nor water would pass. And then, when 7 days had passed, there came to be a kind of a silence. And the silence was eerie. And we knew that the job was finished. We all had to go into the room where my dad had been working and look at what he'd done. And we all said, good dad, I like it very much. I like the way the wallpaper goes that way. That's because we never use that light switch very much, do we? If you think about it. Just night time, really, isn't it? And 1 year he'd gone all up market, and we had coving for the first time ever. It's coving all the way around the ceiling. And just as we're looking at it, which is very good, it's very nice. Just as we're looking at it, he goes. My mum goes, come on, everyone, in the garden again. Come on, let's go. Come on. Come on, picnic time. Yeah. Okay, more music now. This time with a single called I Believe. Please welcome back once more, Marcella Detroit.
Your reasons, but all
Are you sure there are reasons to be right? Oh, 'cause you're a long, long way, a long way from paradise. Don't let your anger or your fear become your suicide. Great enough. We've waited long enough. Now it's time to say goodbye. We got some rules to bend. So many lessons to be learned. Give a little bit of love and you get it back. Give a little bit of pain. One little turn for every little thing that you say.
Marcella Detroit. What a great song. Listen, thanks to everyone. Thanks to the band. Thanks to all of you for coming down here. And, you know, I like to think that perhaps I've brought a little bit of sunshine into your lives. No, that's important to me because, you see, the way I look at it, folks, if I can call you that, the way I look at it, if I bring a little bit of sunshine into your lives, then maybe you might go away and put a little bit of sunshine into someone else's life. And before very long, there'll be sunshine everywhere in this world. Because what I haven't told you, ladies and gentlemen, is that I am Jesus. Thank you very much. Thank you. I am Jesus, and you are my followers. And I would like to say, I must stop doing that. That is a very bad mistake for me. No, I'm joking. I don't mean that when I say that. I'm not Jesus, you know. I say that sometimes just to test out the reaction of people. And you laughed, which is a good reaction. That's healthy. Because I just wonder, these cult religions starting up everywhere, I mean, there are people who take that seriously. And how does a cult religion actually get started? Does someone go out to someone else on the street and say, I am Jesus? Are you? It's a bit of luck, isn't it? I will follow you. I can't think why anyone would want to go and join one of these cult religions. I don't see the reason for that. I can only think of one reason, perhaps, one advantage, and that is that probably you don't get bothered by people from other cult religions. Well, it's not like you're going to get a 9 o'clock call from the Jehovah's Witness, are you? Hello, have you ever wondered where Jesus is? No, he's indoors. Thanks anyway, as long as you know where he is, that's the main thing. Yeah. Bye, yeah. Bloody hell, I thought we were mad. Listen, you've been a great audience. Thanks for coming down. I'll see you again. Good night. Thank you.
Be before we came back the second time to America, George and I said to him, we don't go unless we answer that question, what we feel about the war.
Because you were being asked about it.
Because we've been asked about it all the time. It was just silly, and we had to pretend to be like, you know, in the old days when artists weren't meant to say anything about anything.